So you may be wondering why I'm treading into the waters of the Kabini processors from AMD, and really, I don't know. They're cheap. So Kabini is AMD's low-priced APUs which have a very, very low TDP, which is a surprise for AMD, and with built-in graphics. And get this, a few of them are full-on quad cores. For how much? Under $40 in some cases. Well, are you interested yet? What's the catch? Expensive motherboards? Nope, those are very cheap as well. Well, it's the clock speed. They're clocked way too low for today's standards. So here's a list of AMD's Kabini processors. The Athlon 2650, two cores at 1.45 GHz for $20, and not terrible. The 3850, four cores, 1.3 GHz, almost $40. The 5150, which is what I have for you today, four cores at 1.6 GHz for under $40. The Athlon 5350, four cores at 2.05 GHz, which used to be the top tier Kabini APU and also around $40, but recently AMD came out with the 5370, four cores, but at 2.2 GHz, still very low. Our chip, like I mentioned, is the Athlon 5150, with four processing cores, each clocked at 1.6 GHz with 2 MB of L2 cache, with a TDP of 25 watts, that's super low. And you can actually run this passively cooled with some aftermarket heat sinks I've seen for this. Part of what makes this a good deal is the built-in Radeon R3 graphics, clocked at 600 MHz. Now that's nothing to brag about, but it does mean you can run this chip without a dedicated graphics card. Now, what would make these chips a great bargain is if you could overclock them. Well, what if I told you there was a way? Apparently, there's a BIOS update for the ASUS AM1MA, which allows you to overclock. Unfortunately, I don't have that board here today. I have the MSI AM1M. The board doesn't have too many bells and whistles, the I.O. isn't terrible. Four USB 2.0 ports, two USB 3.0 ports, HDMI, DVI, VGA for your display outs, gigabit Ethernet, and basic audio. A single PCI Express X16 slot, Gen 2, and two PCI Express X1 slots. Only two SATA 3 ports, kind of a bummer there, and lastly two DIMM slots for up to 16 gigabytes of 1600 MHz DDR3 RAM. That sucks for the fact that AMD APUs can typically take advantage of higher clock memory, however this will not be able to. Something that bothers me is the placement of the USB 3.0 header smack dab in the middle of the board. A way that this chipset and these chips themselves are able to distinguish themselves from the rest of AMD is their mounting. And it's not AMD's mounting they've been sticking to for years. It's instead two holes diagonal from each other, and this makes it a tad harder to find an aftermarket cooling solution, which won't be a problem unless the noise gets to you. With these little chips come with a little heatsink, with a tiny fan, and tiny fans are usually loud. Part of me finding out this chip's real value will include me to test games. I know this isn't really meant to be for gaming, but come on, like that stopped me in the past. The system I'll be running contains an Athlon 5150, the MSI AM1M, 8GB of G-School Aries RAM, which would usually be able to be clocked at 2133MHz, but they will be limited to 1600MHz here. A Crucial BX100, 250GB SSD for the boot drive, and lastly, a generic 300W power supply because this system will pull only over 100 watts. So let's go ahead and run some games. See how this thing runs. So at a Tomb Raider 2013, low 720p, we're getting only an average of 25.1 FPS at the lowest settings. That is not playable. Next, CSGO lowest settings at 720p, an average of 48.8 FPS. I can't say that's playable either, especially for Counter-Strike. Morrowind, in Balmora, walking around and shit at 1024 by 768, 26.4 FPS average, not playable. Rocket League, lowest settings at 720p. Oh geez, okay, well there's a trend here, 22.7 FPS, not playable. The Escapists at 1080p, 33.9 FPS average. Now, that's not terrible, it's a very easy game to run, and you don't need high FPS for that, so I'd say that's sort of playable. Next, Trine, very low 720p, 31.6 FPS average. I say that's moderately playable, but it is very low settings, but it's not that bad of a playing experience. Next, Left 4 Dead 2, 720p, lowest settings, 34.2 FPS. That's not exactly playable, but I was able to play through Dead Center. Next, Team Fortress 2. Lowest setting, 720p. We get 28.9 FPS. Still not exactly playable. Now, then we have Minecraft with 8 chunks, I think. Lowest setting, 720p. 69 FPS average, but a minimum of 17. So it was playable. I built a house and some stuff, and yeah, sure. Next, let's get to playable games. Games that were playable. Delver, 1080p, high settings. 59.2 FPS average. That's very good. Then, Castle Crashers, high settings, 1080p. 60 FPS average, 59 minimum. So that pretty much was a solid game. Half-Life, 1080p, 58 FPS. I'm pretty sure everyone could see that coming as a really playable game. That's a very, very old game. Then we have Super Meat Boy, 1080p. And I think VSync might have been able to, or at least half the refresh rate, because it seemed to be sticking at 30 FPS. I couldn't really change that, even though it looked like it could go way beyond that. It looked like it was stuck with some VSync enabled. Lastly, for a synthetic benchmark, we have Cinebench, and it got 125, which is not great, but let's be honest, that's fine for a $40 chip. So even if you aren't looking to game, this system can be bought for under $200 and is perfectly fine for an office PC, you know, for like Word documents and Spotify and other light things, YouTube. But it's not for gaming. So don't say that in the comments how bad of a deal this is for gaming. I already said that here. This processor could have definitely taken advantage of higher clock speeds, like the higher up models, which don't cost a lot more, especially since they've dropped in price. Now, I honestly think this is a decent processor, and I will incorporate it into a build in the future, so look out for that, and I will see you guys next time.